And just in terms of the format, how this is going to work, we're going to give each of the panelists about maybe 12 to 15 minutes to speak, and then we're going to have them come up here to the front, and we're going to allow you to ask some questions so that you can kind of see what their take is on what's going to happen and who will be our next president of the United States, 45th president of the United States.
Thank you. Thank you, Carolyn, and it's wonderful to come to Iowa. I have been here on many occasions with presidential candidates. I actually did RAGBRAI in 1987 with Bruce Babbitt. That was an interesting experience. It was a critical year for me because I did not ride the bicycle because I had two choices that spring. One was to finish my doctoral dissertation, and the other was to ride a bike every day and get in shape for riding RAGBRAI. I made maybe the first and only mature decision of my life, which was to finish my doctoral dissertation. So I basically did RAGBRAI in a van across Iowa. But it was great fun, even though Iowa caucus night here wasn't so good for Bruce Babbitt. Too bad. Anyway, I'm going to open this up with kind of an overview of this crazy process. And I want to start by having you imagine that Franklin Roosevelt and Dwight D. Eisenhower and Jack Kennedy were magically back here with us. And we were talking about electing a president. They would all be familiar with the general election. All right, the Electoral College hasn't changed. Their strategic thinking would have been the same as the strategic thinking of President Obama or Mitt Romney, right? Electoral college, safe states, unsafe states, swing states, put together a majority. You know, they get it. Even though there's the internet and television and all this stuff, it would be strategically exactly the same as they experienced. Now, let them come back and look at the nomination process. And they would say, what? What is this crazy thing? First of all, the concept of momentum, which is so critical coming out of Iowa and New Hampshire, momentum in their day was something that happened only at the convention. Momentum didn't happen beforehand, because in fact, that system was a semi-public system. It wasn't totally closed, as people say, but it was really, the way to think about it, it was semi-public. It was dominated by state conventions, by party bosses, by a process that in fact went on, but it went on largely out of sight of the press, and therefore out of sight of average voters. The voters didn't see what had been happening in that process until the convention happened. And so my favorite example of that is 1964, when Barry Goldwater had a kind of palace coup, took over the entire Republican Party from the precinct level up. And in May of 1964, the New York Times is still applauding Nelson Rockefeller's primary victories. And guess what? Barry Goldwater had the delegates to get nominated. So even the press in those days really couldn't see what was really happening. So that's the way to think about this. The other way to think about this is primaries in those days existed, but they simply were not important. They were beauty contests only, by and large. Jack Kennedy ran in the West Virginia primary not because he needed to win West Virginia's delegates. He ran in the West Virginia primary because he needed to convince the party bosses, like Governor Lawrence, who controlled the Pennsylvania delegation, he needed to convince them that he could win a vote in a Protestant state. He had run in Wisconsin before that, and he thought that would do it. But guess what? The party bosses, being no dummies, looked at the Wisconsin map, no exit polls or anything, but you know, they still did the old-fashioned VO key kind of, for us political scientists, did the old-fashioned VO key kind of analysis. And they could tell that, yeah, he won Wisconsin because he won a huge Catholic vote. So Kennedy had to then look for another primary. But the purpose of that primary was not about delegates. The purpose of that primary was convincing party leaders. So along comes 1968, and there's various revolutions going on. There's a civil rights revolution, there's a women's revolution, there's an anti-war movement, and the Democratic Party is frankly blowing itself up, kind of like the Republicans are today. And the Democrats are blowing themselves up, and among the reasons they're blowing themselves up is that these new entrants can't get into not just the convention, they can't get into the process at all. And the result of that, and for you students, I'd recommend going on YouTube and just looking at some of the YouTube clips from the 1968 convention. That's all you got to do, is look at 10 minutes of it, and you'll get the picture. I always show my class these clips. So the Democratic Party is blowing up. The result of that is the creation of a rules commission, which generally changes the entire nomination system. And I don't even think the reformers at the time knew how much they were changing it. The result was that between 1968 and 1976, with 72 being somewhat of a transition, the nomination process went from being basically a closed process to an open process where primaries dominated. Now, there was no reform rule that said everybody should have primaries. Okay, that's important. Nothing in the rules said anything about that. But the practical effect of these rules was to encourage a lot of states to adopt primaries and, going back to Iowa, to make the Iowa caucuses into something they had never been before. And there were two rules that were important to doing that. One was the rule that all caucuses, all first steps in the process of selecting delegates, had to be held at the same time and the same place throughout a state. Prior to that, what states with caucus systems, they might have them over a week or 2 weeks. But having them at the same time in the same place meant, you could get a statewide picture that very night. The second rule was that everybody at those first steps had to declare a presidential preference. And that had never been the case either. So you had to go in and say who you were for. Well, guess what? That basically turned the Iowa caucuses into what Senator Howard Baker once called the functional equivalent of a primary. Because you could see it, you could count it, and you could report it. And you could report it by 11 o'clock Central Time, which was good enough to get you all over the East Coast, where all the voters are, basically, in time, 10 o'clock Central Time, in time for 11 o'clock news and for all the morning shows. Jimmy Carter was the first candidate to get it about Iowa. He came in second here. The first place finisher was uncommitted. But Mr. Uncommitted wasn't very attractive, didn't have a face or a body or anything. So Jimmy Carter was the winner of the Iowa caucuses. And since then, the process has developed as the only sequential process, the only sequential election process in our American system, with the possible exception of a couple states that have runoffs. But think of the modern nominating process as a sequence. And in this sequence, every contest has an impact on the subsequent contests. And the subsequent contests then have an impact eventually on the convention itself and on the delegates at the convention. And so let's look at it in a couple of stages, and then my minutes will be up. Stage one starts Monday and is basically this year, the month of February. It's Iowa, it's followed by New Hampshire, it's followed by South Carolina and Nevada. Now, why South Carolina and Nevada? Your Iowa politicians, who are pretty smart when it comes to preserving their first in the nation status, and the New Hampshire politicians, equally smart, said, oh dear, we get so much criticism for being lily white states. South Carolina is actually has a huge African American population. So the Democrats and then the Republicans in negotiation with the Democrats agreed that South Carolina would go third. So you would, and because that would be a state with a large African American population. Nevada has a large Latino population. And so Nevada caucuses were placed fourth. That also gave the system an Eastern, a Midwestern, a Southern, and a Western state. After those four are done, we get Super Tuesday, which is an awful lot of states. It still has a southern characteristic. Some people are calling it the SEC primary. And the reason it still has a southern characteristic is that when Jimmy Carter was in the White House and my first job in politics, Jimmy Carter knew that if he put a whole bunch of southern primaries early on, he could just get a huge delegate lead over Ted Kennedy, which he did. And so Jimmy Carter rolled up a nice several hundred delegate lead over Kennedy, and by the time Kennedy started winning primaries later on, Carter had a lead that Kennedy never could overcome. And that was a strategic movement. So one of the things I do in this book, which I encourage everyone to get, is to talk about the evolution of this process. And it's an evolution that has really three or four players, really three big players. The presidential candidates themselves have made over the years changes in the system that they felt had strategic benefits for them. And there's lots of stories of this on the Republican and the Democratic side. The two political parties have fooled around with their rules. The Republicans didn't used to, but in the last 8 years, actually, the Republicans have joined the Democrats in fooling around with their rules because people get these ideas, oh, we lost because of this, or we lost because of that, and then they try to jigger the system. So the political parties. And then the third group, which is very important, are the state political parties and the state legislatures, which often have their own minds about what this should be, what it should look like, et cetera. If you want to know the answer to why we have this crazy system and why there is not a more rational system, it's because nobody is in charge. Or, to put it another way, there are 153 players, each one of them powerful. Congress, the Republican National Committee, the Democratic National Committee, 50 state Republican committees, 50 state Democratic committees, and 50 state legislatures. All of them have some piece of this puzzle, and all of them over the years have exercised their prerogatives to create the system that we have, which makes not a lot of sense to the outside observer. But believe me, if you're a presidential candidate and you're successful, the one thing you've been successful at is understanding what is essentially a public and sequential system. So with that, I'll sit down. We'll go on to the next, okay? Thank you.
All right, let me just start that. Okay, so part of my problem tonight is Carolyn had asked me, and rightly so, to try to put together some pictures. I've been here in Iowa since August, since the state fair, pretty much consistently going around to candidate events, taking notes, lots of pictures, tweeting a lot about the events as I see them. And I've gone to more than 100 candidate events. I've seen every candidate, including some people who were barely candidates. Anybody hear of Lawrence Lessig? All right, yeah, well, I saw him. He gave a PowerPoint as his speech. How about anybody heard of Mark Everson? Oh, all right. Former IRS commissioner said he was running for president. He came and gave a speech at the Des Moines Register soapbox at the state fair. So I spent several hours last night desperately trying to curate some of these pictures, only to leave them in a folder on my computer and to leave my laptop in Des Moines. So that's what I've been doing here. I've been trying to find multiple ways to get access to the stuff that's on my iPad, and I couldn't come up with until the very end here when I realized I could plug the iPad into the computer, let iTunes run and all that. So I have a few pictures. My idea originally was to just let the things run behind me and talk a little bit about what I've seen in the Iowa caucuses. And then I remembered this and thought, there's only a very brief clip of him, but I think it's kind of fun. Let's see if it's the right clip. So I think, Martin O'Malley singing the Iowa waltz at the end of his event, I thought was just perfect. So we're gonna see if this comes up as I want it to, which is sort of a chronological. Mostly I have stuff from the state fair that I managed to pull up here and a couple things at the end, and I'm sorry about that. I had a lot of pictures, and some of the bad pictures are probably up because I didn't have time to go through them. So we'll see what happens as a slideshow, and I'll just talk a little bit. So as I said, I was here at the Iowa State Fair, which happens in August, and George Washington was one of the speakers at the Des Moines Register soapbox. They kicked it off with him. You'll see a lot of candidates. Among the various things that happen in Iowa, the most interesting to me, of course, is the fact that the candidates come here. Right? And boy, do they come here over and over and over again. If you go to the Des Moines Register, I wish this was going more slowly, but I'm not going to worry about it. It'll just run over and over, I hope. If you go to the Des Moines Register's website, they have something called the Candidate Tracker. And even though we're now at the end, the tracker is great. And one of the things it will tell you is exactly how many events each candidate did. The last time I looked, Rick Santorum had done 280 some odd events. I shouldn't say they were odd events. 280 or so events here in Iowa in the run-up to the caucuses. Hillary Clinton had done about 100 or something like that, I think, is what I just most recently saw. But the candidates come here. Because the candidates come here, the media comes here, right? And because the media comes here, the candidates come here. And it just becomes this kind of over and over sort of thing that's happening. But it's an amazing opportunity for voters. I should say this was waiting for Donald Trump at the Butter Cow. Donald Trump never showed up at the Butter Cow, partly because he couldn't have gotten into the space if he'd wanted to. But it's an amazing thing, right, that all these candidates come to Iowa, and they spend their time here in Iowa going around to all the small towns and the bigger towns, and they talk to voters. This really does not happen except in a very few places in America, right? Iowa, New Hampshire, to some extent South Carolina these days. But we get past that, and voters in the rest of the states are going to see fairly typical media-oriented campaigns. But voters in Iowa expect to be able to get close to the candidates, expect to be able to ask questions, expect to be able to shake hands, and I don't have many up here, but the selfie has become the big thing, right? After the events, it's the selfie. Let's do the selfie. And cheeseheads were here harassing Scott Walker, actually. They were there protesting him. But it's, for me, it started with the Des Moines Register soapbox, which I think is the coolest thing in the world, right? The Des Moines Register's rules at the State Fair are very simple. You get a microphone, you get 20 minutes, and you get a platform to stand on and go to it. So you can do whatever you want. Carly Fiorina, who we just saw, came in about halfway through, and after listening at that point to about 10 soapbox speeches over a couple of days, she stood up and she said, I'm not gonna give a speech, I just want your questions. Which I thought was absolutely brilliant, actually, in the context of the soapbox. And she did the Q&A, she'd ask a question, somebody asked a question, and she'd give a little bit of her speech. Right, so by the time she was done, she had done her own speech, but she'd made it feel very interactive to the voters who were standing there right in front of her. So this is in the early stages. I mean, August is not that early for the campaign, but in the sense of people starting to pay attention, it's relatively early. The thing that really struck me at the State Fair in August, and I've been listening for it ever since, and I think it defines part of this campaign, is that I could take language from the Republicans and put it in the Democrats' mouths, and you wouldn't know that it was something odd. In other words, Republicans were talking about inequality. They were talking about it in their own way, but they were talking about inequality. Right? They were drawing out of, I think, out of the sense that the Occupy movement was saying something people cared about, but they were doing it in a way that, the example, Carly Fiorina again. She got up there. Of course, she's been the head of a major corporation which had some financial challenges and issues at the time she was its head. It was not, we were in a rough economy. And she... her company laid off 30,000 workers. Carly Fiorina was up here on the stage at the Des Moines Register soapbox telling us about how corporations are hurting the working guy. And you know, not in a sense that she was trying to be strange about it or anything else, but that message, that part of the message this year is coming from both sides, which I think is absolutely fascinating. Now, again, for the Republicans, much of the time, it's not corporations, it's big government that's, frankly, screwing you, the little guy, over, right? And we got to get them off your back. The Democrats have a different boogeyman that's screwing the little guy over, but they're both talking about the same stuff in their own ways. And I think that's absolutely fascinating. It led me kind of thinking about how Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump might be the same guy, in a sense. In the sense that as I've gone to Donald Trump events, I've gone to Bernie Sanders events, we're just gonna roll through again. I've gone to Bernie Sanders events, Donald Trump events, and I hear them saying really similar messages, right? We need a revolution for Bernie. For Donald, it's vote for me and I'll change everything, right? But either way, it's still, vote for me, and it will be completely different when you do so. Bernie wants us to do this political revolution, vote for him, change everything, change the world. Donald Trump, vote for me, I'm a winner, together we'll all win, we'll be winners, let's win together. But there's a really similar theme in here, and they're both attracting frustrated, angry, distressed voters on both sides. So that, in a sense, they both have really kind of similar connections, right? It's an emotional connection. It's a connection that says, you know, I don't like the world the way it is, and I've got to change it. Now, I did an op-ed in the Des Moines Register a couple weeks ago in which I said a lot of folks are, I'm sorry to say, I think kind of doomed to disappointment. And they're doomed to disappointment, and if many of you may be as well, because we have imbued our, we've said the president is going to change everything, and I'm sorry, the president is not going to change everything, whether it's Donald Trump or Bernie Sanders or Barack Obama, right? Why Bernie Sanders? Because Barack Obama disappointed those on the left who didn't get all, as Sarah Palin put it, the hopey changey stuff they thought they were gonna get, right? Why is Donald Trump attractive? Why are Republicans disappointed? Because they elected a Republican Congress and Barack Obama's still in office. He's still doing things, how dare he, right? Well, I'm telling you that when you elect a new president, on day one, they keep telling us what their agenda is, Rubio and Cruz in particular, and most of it cannot be done on day one, and most of it cannot be done by them alone, right? The system is designed to require that the executive and the legislature, in some form or another, come to an agreement to do things. And so that's kind of my takeaway, right? I think this is cool, I think it's important, I think Iowa's critical, and I guess, I don't know what anymore what I did with my book, but Carolyn and I and Todd Donovan, Why Iowa? We talk about the role Iowa plays, and we'll see if we're right this time around. But it is critical, and the president matters, but there's a lot more to it than the kind of rhetoric we're getting on either side. And I guess maybe it's after watching 100 plus events, I now understand the media's tendency to be cynical, I guess, right? When you hear the same thing over and over and over again. For a long time, I could almost recite Marco Rubio's stump speech because he didn't change it no matter who the audience was, over and over and over again. Yet it's important. Yet they are saying things that are important and they matter. And the fact that we get here in Iowa, as I still think of myself as an Iowan, this opportunity to connect, to talk, to query them, I think is critically, critically important for the system. And so that's, I'll stop at that point.
We are doing Twitter and the 2016 election. We started in March. We've been collecting Twitter messages ever since March for each of the candidates and a few other things as well. We now have something on the order of 68 million Twitter messages, which is a big stack, a little hard to go through, but I will show you something about how you can get through this big stack. Okay, now, I want to frame this a little bit differently. That is to say, I want to say, look, we've known forever that when the infrastructure of communication changes, society is transformed. Well, the infrastructure of communication has just changed. Almost nobody here would remember Harry Truman. Harry Truman did whistle stop. That's how he ran his campaign for the presidency. He got in a train and he crossed the country. That was the last time a whistle stop worked. Okay, from that point on, our politics has been television politics, except in the state of Iowa, where we managed to avoid the television politics at least a little bit. But ever since, it's been television. Now, we're undergoing a similar kind of transition, and that transition is in terms of social media. Twitter is not the only social media that's important, but Twitter is the one that we can get our hands on relatively easy and accumulate and work with. So that's what we're working with. I want to tell you about this transition, and I want to tell you how it happens in a very concrete way. The way it happens in a concrete way is Bernie Sanders goes to Portland. Okay, at the point at which he was going to Portland, the Washington Post was measuring, we had a firm that was measuring counts. They were about counts of Twitter, but they were also about counts of the media. And it turned out at that point that of all the counts of media that they could get their hands on that mentioned, that were included either Hillary Clinton or Bernie Sanders, Hillary Clinton had 95% of them, he had 5% of them. So he goes to Portland, and he's greeted by 28,000 enthusiastic people. How in the world did they learn anything about him? Where in the world could they have learned about Bernie Sanders, a senator from Vermont? That's not exactly a great starting point. Well, the answer is fairly straightforward. Here. Let's call it a transition to self-organizing micro-targeting. Micro-targeting is a favorite frame of politicians around and political scientists who want to talk about elections. And we want to talk about self-organizing micro-targeting because the way they found out was social media. That is, people who already knew about Bernie Sanders were telling their friends. And this example is just how they knew where to go. Because the venue had to change, because they started out thinking it was going to be this many people, and that was not nearly a big enough venue, and they started out, okay, so how do you find out where to go? Well, you get Twitter messages. So if you look at this, this is the day in which the rally was held. On 3 days before that, there were 452 Twitter messages that mentioned Mr. Sanders in Portland, and that went to 921,000 people. Now, there were more than that, because I don't get a full list, but of the ones that we could acquire, there were 452 and they went to 921,000 people. They had 921,000 followers. And the same is true here, 282 and 900,000, 486 and 900,000, over 1,000 and 1,400 people. So, that's how they found out, because there wasn't any other way. The Sanders campaign didn't have a local organization. Mass media was not telling you much about Mr. Sanders, so this is how they found out. Now, there is one other possibility for the mass media, and the one other possibility is, you notice here all these URLs. Those are all references to sources of communication. So maybe the mass media provided the people who are doing those 452 tweets with information which they're passing along to their friends. And that way we would be able to keep the mass media into this process, except how you can count. Well, I have a rough idea about mass media. Yeah, I had a list of 15, and there were 2,000 Twitter messages, right? Okay, CNN was in 28 of them. CBS was in 9. The New York Times was in 7. Okay, that's not exactly a very big deal. Over here are some things which are not mass media. The ones I've listed are the ones that were repeated at least 20 times. And so the leader is Facebook with 413 mentions. And then you get a Bernie Sanders webpage, which is a URL which will lead you there. And you can see how much they are. And all told, it's 1,280. So in the 2000 Twitter messages, there were 1,280 from that population. So it wasn't mass media, right? It was some other kind of media that was going on. Now, can I generalize this? Well, let me generalize it this way. It's really about followers. When you retweet a message and it goes to your followers, what you get is a geometric explosion of communication. So this is our 68 million Twitter messages and the people the 9 million people who posted those 68 million Twitter messages. Okay, so we ask how many followers do you have? That's a piece of information that's readily available. Well, there were 2.7 million who said they had between 0 and 100, but there were 3.5 million who said they had between 100 and 500. There was 1 million of these people who said they had between 500 and 1,000, and then there's another almost 100,000 that is 1,000 to 5,000, and there are 224 of those people who said they had more than 5,000 Twitter messages. Now, some of these are mass media. That is, New York Times has 12 million followers and so forth. But if you look at this, what you can see is that they're very widely spread, especially within politics. Politics is quite distinctive in this way. Especially within politics, people have lots of followers. And so as soon as people start retweeting, you get an explosion of communication. All right, now to Iowa. Good. I just wanted to know where I was. Okay. One of the things that we have done, in addition to collecting Twitter messages about the candidates, is to collect messages about a hashtag, which is IA Caucus. And this is the distribution beginning in October 1st and then ending up where we are today, because that was yesterday. That top one was yesterday. So what you see is, first let me point out that there are a whole bunch of bumps in here. Now, most of those bumps have to do with the debates. When a debate happens, people pay attention, and they start sending Twitter messages. This, on the other hand, is something different. Well, it is the debate. Mr. Trump said, I'm not going. They need me more than I need them. I'm out of here. That produced a huge round of Twitter messages, and so... So if you, so I want to tell you a story that's connected, that's directly connected with that, okay? That is to say, she came to town, right? Okay, the mass media thought this was the greatest thing they'd seen in a long time. Every single piece of media that you can imagine had a story about her, and almost all of them had a picture, because she's a celebrity, and they wanted to have a picture of her in their media. Now, what happened in the Iowa caucus stuff? Now, this is a point at which we're talking about really big numbers as opposed to those little numbers down there. Well, here are the 3 days before anything happened. On the day before she came, there were three messages that mentioned her. On the day she came, out of more than 10,000, there were 439 that mentioned her, and then 168, and then 52. So one of the things that I can find out is, how much difference did she make? How much attention did she get from people who are really interested in the Iowa caucuses as opposed to people who do journalism for a profession? And that, it seems to me, is part of the story. Okay, then, last point. This is a surge, okay? If you go back to January, as recently as January 20, these three candidates who are Trump and Trump and Cruz and Rubio are almost equal in terms of number of Twitter messages being produced about them. This, over this period of time, the number of Twitter messages grows greatly, and that's the one that goes the most. Now, it goes the most, of course, because of what he said. He said, you know, I'm out of here. Now, there is a potential problem with all of those messages. They could all be wrong, right? They could all be saying, this guy is too full of himself. I don't want to have anything to do with him. I certainly wouldn't want to vote for him. So we have to be able to say, well, what is the affect of those messages? This is one of the things we're doing. We have a website. It's called rightleftpolitics.com, and every day it's updated. In this case, we're showing you the sentiment analysis that we have done. And so Mr. Trump is red, and it starts back here in November, and all the way across you can see he's pretty stable. And even at the end, even when he has made this statement, he still is very positive. Up is positive, down is negative. Mr. Rubio gets up to equal to him once. Mr. Cruz gets up to equal to him once and then falls down. Rubio is, you know, more or less equal. But what you have to remember is that there are differences in numbers here. That is, if I go back to the previous slide, there are this many messages about Mr. Trump, most of which are positive. There are this many messages about Mr. Rubio, most of which are positive. But that's not a very big base from which to run a campaign. And that's a pretty big base to run, from which to run a campaign. So, okay. So, from my point of view, the conclusion is what we begin to see in action is self-organizing micro-targeting. That is, Bernie Sanders doesn't need to have the kind of micro-targeting that other candidates are trying to have because his followers are doing the micro-targeting for him. Mr. Trump is in exactly the same position. Now, every word that he says is broadcast by the media, but it is his followers who are doing the spread of this. And so what we can look forward to is a sort of new kind of politics which includes all the old politics, but also includes self-organizing micro-targeting.
Before I begin, results of the last Ann Seltzer Des Moines Register poll. Trump 28, Cruz 23, Rubio 15, Carson 10. On the Democratic side, Hillary Clinton 45, Bernie Sanders 42. That's as of 2 minutes ago. O'Malley 3. There you go. Negative 3. So I want to say it's a real pleasure to be here in Iowa. I was here in 2012, and I've been here since yesterday, which means I've been to 3% of the number of events that David Redlawsk has been to in Des Moines and Hubbard and Ames so far today. As Caroline mentioned, I helped to run a blog called The Monkey Cage. The motto of The Monkey Cage, which comes from a quote by H.L. Mencken, is democracy is the art of running the circus from the monkey cage, which is an apt metaphor for this election year. And this character here, who's our sort of mascot, is actually an orangutan, not a monkey, if you want to be precise about primates. And something about that expression, covering his eyes, also, I think, is appropriate for this particular year. One of the things that we do with the monkey cage is we try to use quantitative information and political science theory and evidence to help us understand politics. And so I'm going to try to do that today for this particular primary by looking at four graphs in particular, and one quote from a book that's been called the second greatest book ever written. So the first thing I want to just talk about is the way in which the two-party primaries differ so much this year. In one party, the Democrats, they have in some sense decided on a candidate. And one of the ways that political scientists, mainly spurred by some of the researchers in this room, measure the coalescing of the party or not is by counting up the number of endorsements that prominent party leaders make of each of the two or three or 17 candidates, as the case may be. On the Democratic side, we're going to look just quarter by quarter for the year before the election year. And if endorsements came before that year, then we'll put them in the first quarter. And if the Iowa caucus happened to be a little bit later, we'll count those as being before the election itself. So these are, in some sense, are all the pre-Iowa endorsements. And this is the pace of endorsements for these election years, okay? And here I want to just draw your attention to how quickly, how early the Democratic Party as manifest in these endorsements by sitting governors, senators, and members of the House, coalesced around Hillary Clinton. Okay, she has the vast mass majority of these endorsements. She has more endorsements in January, February, March of 2015 than she, Edwards, and Obama did in total on the eve of the Iowa caucus in 2008. Right? So people say, well, how could Hillary Clinton win? Maybe she won't win. She had more endorsements in 2008, and she still lost. Well, it's a whole nother year for Hillary Clinton in comparison to 2008. On the Republican side, it's a much different story. The pace of endorsements is slow. There's not very many endorsements have been made. It's only slightly more than they had in 1980 and 2012 at this time. And a little bit later, I'll show you just quickly, of course, of the people that have endorsed, there's no consensus frontrunner of any sort. And so in a sense, the Republican race sets up very differently than the Democratic race, and this is just one quantitative way of looking at that. And it suggests that on the Republican race, there's a lot more indecision and therefore a lot more fluidity, malleability, and uncertainty in the race, which I think gels with what we all can perceive today. One of the potential implications of that then is that there's probably more fluidity in people's opinions. There's more ability for news and information that people receive to influence those opinions. And so if we want to talk about the media and the role of the media in the Republican primary, that means we're talking about one candidate, one man in particular, and I mean Rick Santorum. So I want to show you, I'm just kidding, it's Donald Trump. So I want to show you a graph of Trump's percentage of mentions of all of the Republican candidates in a sample of cable news and local broadcast television networks that was collected by the Internet Archive and compiled by the GDELT campaign television tracker. You can see, not surprisingly, a small change in the race on or about June 16th, 2015, when Trump joined the race. And what I wanted to point out here, a couple features of this graph. First of all, just sort of, if you kind of, you can see there's some ups and downs and bounciness in the trend. But if you sort of draw kind of like, oh, what's a mental average, right, of the period here between when he announces and at the end of this graph? What is his average percent? It's about 50%, which is to say half of the coverage of all the GOP candidates goes to Donald Trump, and everybody else gets to divvy up the other half, all right? So that's the world in which the Republican candidates have been living. A couple of other things to point out here. One is that you can see I've sort of identified a couple of spikes here. And you can see how the controversial comments that Donald Trump made initially about John McCain when he suggested that he didn't want a candidate that would get captured, right? You know, that wasn't heroic enough. You can see that enabled him to have a little spike in news coverage. You can see a period of time where his coverage began to wane and then dropped off as sort of Ben Carson kind of popped up in the news because people started to do some fact-checking of some of his biographical details and didn't always quite pan out the way maybe he was telling the story. And what's fascinating to me about this graph is, you know, in some sense, I cannot get in the mind of Donald Trump. If I could, I'd have made some money or something by now. But the point is, he, you know, when he was sitting here kind of, for him, out of the news cycle, he said and did some things that changed that, right? He first suggested that we should have a database of Muslims. This was followed by a rally the next day. There'd be one next dot, which is in Birmingham, Alabama, which was a massive rally, like many Trump rallies, and a Black Lives Matter activist was removed. And then Trump said something later about it was good that he got roughed up, or something along those lines, right? So yeah, another day of coverage. And then here is just to note the statement he made about perhaps having a ban on all Muslims coming to the United States. And on that day, just to sort of draw, he got 80% of all of the mentions of the Republican candidates on television news in this particular sample. So this is what we all have observed, just shown to you graphically. The relationship between the amount of news you get and the amount of polls you get, we can graph that too. This is the average share of television news coverage over this period from the day Trump announced till January 25th. This is your average national share in the polls. And you can start to see, okay, the candidates that have gotten more news coverage have generally done a little bit better in the polls. Carson, Cruz, Rubio, Bush, Walker. And then down here you can see the other ones, Fiorina, Huckabee, Christie, Kasich, Perry, and the runs at the bottom, right, who, you know, you might as well just say given all the news coverage that they've gotten. And you might say to yourself, you know, well, this is great. Where's Donald Trump on this graph? And there he is. You know, and so whenever I sort of talk about these kinds of correlations, you know, people know enough to say, well, wait a minute, what's the chicken and what's the egg here? And I think there's a little bit of both happening, but the way that I would sort of frame the story for you is to say, look, the first thing that moves is news. No one on June 15th or 16th, you know, in the morning says, you know, I think I'm a Trump supporter today, just for the heck of it. We're all like, wake up in the morning, you know, it's a Trump day, you know? But what happens after the amount of news coverage that he receives is the poll numbers move, right? So it's the news driving the poll numbers. Now, that at a certain point, you can imagine that some kind of self-reinforcing cycle kicks in because the polls justify further news coverage. He's the front runner. The news media always pays more attention to the front-running candidates relative to your Jim Gilmore's down here, okay? So that's the cycle that's in some sense driven by the continual good polls, lots of news, more good polls, more news. And that's what, in some sense, has taken us all the way to this present moment. So ultimately, the fascinating thing is, by the way, do you know who understood this dynamic in 1987? Okay. Trump. This quote, I learned a lot from that experience. A good publicity is preferable to bad. And from a bottom line perspective, bad publicity is sometimes better than no publicity at all. Controversy in short sells. I mean, he telegraphed his campaign, you know, I think, with that line in The Art of the Deal, the second greatest book ever written. What's the first greatest book? The Bible, of course, as he has said, although I'm sure that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are feeling the heat. So there's another gospel on the scene. So, you know, I think Trump understands the media, understands the way that the news media works and the incentives that it creates pretty well. And he's capitalized on that in this particular cycle. So, you know, if you put that kind of story together with some of these other indicators of the race, it's fascinating to me just how much more muddled the Republican race is this year, even than in 2012, which we kind of thought then was sort of a muddled race. But I'll show you a few things to just give you one comparison. In this sort of series of graphs, what I'm showing you is what percentage of the endorsements have the candidates gotten of the total population of Republican governors, senators, and members of the House? What percent of them, how much money have they raised? How much news did they get between July and December, right? This is 2011 in this graph, okay? And then what's their median share in the national polls over that same period? So in 2011, Romney was by no means the strongest front runner the Republican Party has ever produced, but he had the most endorsements, right? He had the most money. He was second only to Perry in news coverage, and he probably would have been first if Rick Perry hadn't stepped on his own toes about 30 times. And overall, although plenty of other candidates had surges and declines in the polls, the average was still Romney. Okay? So when we wrote our book about 2012, at the moment of the eve before the Iowa caucus, I felt pretty comfortable saying that Mitt Romney was the front runner. Now, thank goodness he won, right? Or I would have been embarrassed. But that looks quite a bit different than what we have in 2015. So now you have many more candidates, of course. The endorsements, there's no clear leader. Bush and Rubio each have a small fraction, okay? Cruz has a slightly smaller fraction, and it's down from there. Trump has none. No endorsements of sitting governors, senators, okay? Now, maybe like an occasional governor having quit her position, you know, could have endorsed him, but you go to the money raise. Now, this is money raised by the candidates. Of course, the super PACs have money, too, and Bush's super PAC in particular has a lot. But it's still instructive to look even at the individual fundraising to see that, you know, you would sort of think if you're a front-running candidate, you can beat the other candidates even in individual fundraising, right, maybe over and above super PAC fundraising. That's not clear, right? Carson's actually raised the most as of the third quarter of 2015. Cruz is second, Bush is third. And then the rest. And then if we go to news and to polls, I mean, I just to dwell on that Trump number again for the minute, I mean, look at that. You know, look how much more coverage he's gotten, even compared to any candidate in 2012. And of course, he's also been leading in the national polls. And so, you know, what we have in 2015 are different indicators of candidate strength all pointing in different directions compared to what was true in 2011 and to some other primaries. So I think, you know, where this leaves us, at least me, you know, giving a presentation now on the eve of the Iowa caucus, if I was normally doing this, in this kind of audience or I was talking to my students, I would love to have a nice, confident prediction. I would love to have a big concluding thought. So I thought about it for a while, and I came up with a big concluding thought. I don't have a big concluding thought. I would be very comfortable, as I assume most political observers would, saying that Bernie Sanders has an uphill battle ahead of him. He's not the front runner, even if he's 3 points behind in Iowa. But beyond that, I don't know what to say. I can tell you what's going to happen on Monday night in this state, and I certainly can't tell you who the GOP nominee is going to be. So right now, I'm certain about uncertainty, but not much more than that. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, that is a little strange. Sarah and Caroline for having us. I am going to talk about political messaging, and on the eve of the Iowa caucus, as John said, I'm going to talk not about the Iowa caucus, but about the general election, and I'm going to think about what's happening in the primaries and the caucus in the context of the general election. So we're going to skip ahead and just start here. How to win a presidential election in 3 easy steps. Okay, so it's never been quite this simple. The way I think about this is the easiest way to win is to be the incumbent party candidate in a growing economy. Okay, that's good. Most of the time, those guys win. If you are that person, you talk a lot about that good economy. Okay, that's an important element. And then if you're not that person, you change the topic. Okay, so incumbent party in a growing economy, or the challenger in a sinking economy, so Barack Obama in 2008. But you want to have that economic wind at your back. And if you don't, then you want to change what we're talking about. Okay, so that's not so easy. You have some choices. You're constrained by who you are. Okay, so you can't, you know, if you're Bernie Sanders, you cannot sell to the American people the idea that you have new ideas, youth and enthusiasm. That doesn't sell, right? It doesn't go together. So you're constrained by who you are. Maybe you're constrained by the past positions that you've taken after a long career in the state house or in the Senate or wherever. So you have to maximize, given who you are, and some other constraints that are more political, like you want this issue, whatever it is, to have a lopsided distribution in terms of public opinion. Nobody wins on a 50-50 issue. Okay, you need 50% plus one. So to be there, you want it to be even more lopsided, so you don't have any uncertainty. Okay, so you're looking for an issue where public opinion is lopsided and where you benefit more than your opponent on the lopsidedness. Doesn't do any good to reset the agenda of the election onto an issue where public opinion is lopsided if your opponent has the more popular position. Okay, these seem like obvious things. Candidates often get them wrong. Okay, so lopsided public opinion, you benefit more than your opponent, and then, of course, it has to be an issue that can be made to be important or already is important. Okay, so, you know, colonizing the moon. When I was here 4 years ago, Newt Gingrich, I promise you, I'm not making this up, was talking about colonizing the moon. Okay, so colonizing the moon, you're not resetting the agenda of the election onto colonizing the moon. Okay, so lots of constraints to balance, and you're looking for this issue. Okay, so a few examples of what I'm talking about. In 1960, Kennedy turned that election into an all-out battle for the future of the world between the United States and the Soviet Union. And he went around talking about the new frontier. So he said, we stand today on the edge of a new frontier, and we're going to go amazing places, to space, to the depths of the ocean. And he said the Soviet kids were better at math than our kids. They were better musicians. They were writing better symphonies. They were writing better poetry. It was across all these spectrums that he wanted increased support for. Okay, so that's what he was saying out loud. And what he was really saying to people is, oh, I forgot to fix the typo. You told me about that. There's going to be another one I forgot to fix, too. Okay, what he was really saying to people is, we're going to crush the Soviets. And that was a popular message. Everybody wanted to crush the nearly everybody wanted to crush the Soviets. Okay, so similarly, in 1968, Richard Nixon went around talking about restoring order to American cities. Our cities are on fire. People feel like they're not safe. He would tell stories about secretaries who didn't think they could go for walks after making supper at night because they didn't feel safe in their neighborhoods. What he's really saying is, I know you're scared of integrating the cities. Okay, again, something with a lopsided distribution. Most people in 1968 thought that integration was moving too fast. So he's leveraging this dimension, just like Kennedy is leveraging this dimension of beating the Soviets, of defeating communism, the Cold War. By the way, interestingly, the same thing that Stevenson twice tried to leverage in 52 and 56, but didn't do as well as Kennedy did. So the theme here is that when candidates do this successfully, when they steal elections away from candidates that have the economy at their back, and admittedly, these two examples that I'm giving you are, you know, barely, the economy is barely favoring the incumbents here. Okay, so that's a preview of where I think we're going this year. But when they do this, they do it by weaving stories that are very broad and very thematic, okay, but are tapping into an underlying dimension. One example of a candidate who gets it wrong. In 1964, Barry Goldwater ran around the country talking about nuclear weapons and saying he wanted a knob. lob a nuclear bomb into the men's room of the Kremlin and make sure it hit. Okay, he said, a little nuclear power is just enough. I want to disabuse Americans of their fear of the word nuclear. Okay, so he's really saying to people, you're probably going to die. Okay, nobody is for that. And in 1964, most Americans thought that they would see World War III in their lifetime and that they would die in it. Okay, and he's leveraging this dimension on which his opponent is more popular. Okay, so it's not necessarily easy, given who you are. For some candidates, you know, maybe given who they are and the positions they've taken and who they're running against, that's also very important, there just isn't an issue like this. Okay, so this is the trick. So John talked about this book we wrote in 2012, The Gamble. And we collected a lot of data, 1,000 people a week, every week, for 45 weeks of 2012. So I'm going to use that data now to demonstrate to you why I think even if you're good at figuring out what this message is, persuasion is very hard in general elections. Okay, and that is largely because of the role of party identification. But what I'm showing you here is 2011, our early poll results. So pretend, you know, that you can think of this as just one big poll in December of 2011, okay, and that's where we end up. And then in 2012, in the columns, this is our big post-election poll with everyone, so 45,000 people. And the numbers that I want you guys to focus on are the main diagonal elements here. So 45% of the people were with Obama in 11 and stuck with him in 12. Okay, 42% of the people are with Romney in 11 and stuck with him all throughout. Maybe they're moving around in the middle, I'm not showing you that, and some people are, but they come home to him in 2012. So if we sum up that main diagonal, we see that about 87% of the electorate has a stable position from 11 to 12. So depending on who you are and what your priors are, maybe, you know, that's a lot of people moving around, or maybe that's not that many people moving around. But it isn't as if, and this number is, you know, pretty, I don't know, surprising to me, is pretty constant. You can make this table for 2014, for 2008, for 2010, and you get roughly the same kind of stability. Okay, so 20%, 14%, whatever, of the population is up for grabs, okay, potentially movable. So I want to use these ideas to try to understand what's happening right now and a little bit about Donald Trump. I kind of feel guilty every time I talk about him. So we were talking about this last night at dinner with the reporters. You know, they sit there and they say, like, you know, God, all the Trump coverage. You know, I wish that it was not so much Trump coverage. And, you know, John and I are kind of looking at them like, you guys are the ones covering him, you know. And so I feel a little bit bad every time I want to talk about the primaries and the caucus, and I end up saying, oh, I'm going to talk about Trump, but I am. Okay, so the story of Trump, he announces his candidacy, he engages in this surprising level of stereotyping and ethnocentrism, and he becomes more popular every time he does this. as John said, he's got no endorsements and by his own declaration is not raising money. All right, so initial reactions to Trump, oh, he'll fade. Okay, so I've said many of these, all right? So he'll fade, he's getting a pass because he's in character, in the Apprentice character. He's a reality TV star, he draws big crowds. So what? What do we make of that? Maybe no one's gonna show up. The party will eventually coordinate around an insider. Poor Scott Walker really thought he was gonna start something. And attack ads are gonna chip away at his support. So these are all the kinds of things that we expected to see happen and we have not yet seen. So I think that a lot of what is going on with Trump is in his message. Okay, so he, in my view, has given a voice to a set of citizens who we knew existed. He didn't create these opinions. They were always there. But these people have rarely been given permission by a major party presidential candidate to talk freely about their beliefs. Okay, so he has empowered a set of people by priming a dimension of American politics that was latent, okay, and often not explicitly expressed. All right, so why do I think this? So John and I have been gathering the same kind of data in 2015 and 16 that we did in 11 and 12. And what I'm showing you here is data from 3,000 people who were surveyed in December and January. And I'm plotting for you on the x-axis a measure of what you can think of as people's level of racial anxiety. How uncomfortable are people with the idea of others? In this particular case, it's African Americans. Okay, but we have low levels of racial anxiety and high levels of racial anxiety. So we're moving across the x-axis like that, and we're moving in quartiles of that measure. On the y-axis is the percent of the Trump vote within each of these quartiles. Okay, and I'm showing this to you for, I'll back up a little bit. This one is the racial resentment measure. Okay, and so what you can see here is across the quartiles, Trump support increases as people's levels of racial anxiety increase. So he's doing really well, 60% of his support among people with high levels of racial animus. He's getting 60% of their votes. This one is a question about immigration, okay, and whether you think immigrants are an immediate threat to society. So from low to high, people who think that, right, he is getting a lot of the support among these people. And this is measuring white ethnocentrism, okay, so whites relative to others. And among people who have high levels of ethnocentrism, again, Trump does extremely well among those people. Right, so if you take these together, okay, high levels of racial anxiety, you know, thinking that immigrants are feared, wanting to keep Muslims out. Okay, Trump does really well among that set of people. These attitudes were not born overnight. John said you don't wake up and say, oh, today's a Trump day. Well, you don't wake up and hold these attitudes. Okay, so they're latent in people, and he is allowing people to express them through their support for him. Okay, so another way that we can think about this is by looking at what their candidates are actually saying on the campaign trail. So I've been doing a little work with the ads. There have been 189,000 airings of political commercials since January 1st of 2015. Half of them have been in Iowa. So 102,000 airings of ads. God bless you people. Okay, now, somewhat surprisingly, 80% of them have been positive. This is a change from past cycles. Okay, so this is not an attack cycle of advertising. 80% positive, 15% contrast, 5% attack. 64% of them have been aired by candidates. Again, something that people didn't expect. This was supposed to be the year of the super PAC, the year of dark money. 4% of these 189,000 ads by dark money, 501c4 groups. So largely candidate-driven, largely positive. That is the same across both parties. The Democrats are very different here. But, you know, 51% candidate ads, only 5% dark money ads, even on the Republican Party, all for Marco Rubio. No other candidate. Kasich had one last week, but largely positive. Okay, so what are the ads saying? This is a still image from Donald Trump's first ad, and there it is. black and white photo. You guys all read the news coverage that this photo isn't actually of the border with Mexico. But stop illegal immigration, Trump. Okay, priming that dimension. How is he inviting people to express these attitudes that have been latent for them? Through these kinds of images, and of course his language every day. Here's another still image from a Trump ad, temporary ban on, you know, very plain spoken. In comparison to an ad that I hope everyone in the room has seen, the Bernie Sanders, Simon and Garfunkel ad, which is lovely. It's a minute, 60-second ad. It's a lovely ad. And the theme here, as you could probably just take away from the signifiers in this image, is that there are so many people searching for America. Okay, and we just want to be together and find the country, allegedly, like that we lost. Okay, so the same kind of message. Does anybody know whose ad this is? Of course you do. You're 102,000 airings of ads. Somebody who is not even here today is spending the entire weekend in New Hampshire, so it doesn't surprise me that he would not be in your repertoire. John Kasich. So John Kasich's whole campaign is Kasich for us. Okay, it's the same idea as the Sanders campaign. We're all together. Okay, so I want to think about the difference between Trump's American anxiety advertising, right? Making America great again suggests that it's not great anymore, but it once was. And so we need to go back in time to that time when it was once great. And what that means is, in the parlance of, you know, we're all gonna die, or I know you don't wanna integrate the cities, what that means is, good God, where did the 1950s go? Okay, and so we're gonna go make it great again, versus this Kasich inclusive message. And what I'll leave you with is just the thought that I started with. In terms of an issue that is lopsided, on which you have an advantage over your opponent, thinking about the general election, which one of these two Republican candidates do you think has the best shot of beating the Democratic nominee if the economy is slowly growing? So which one of these two issues is going to work to steal more independents? Because remember the stability graph I showed you. Steal more independents and Democrats away from what might otherwise be a different choice. And I'll leave you guys to think about that. Thank you.
Could ask a question, but if there is, I'd rather you all ask a question. So, is there a question from the floor from our group? Yeah, Carrie, back here.
So there's a couple thoughts. I mean, one is Trump unique? I think so. I think that a more typical pattern would be that candidates dominate the news for a shorter period of time, and then usually deal with what Fiorina and Carson have dealt with in this cycle, you know, which is kind of a downturn as the news media scrutinizes their record and the nature of the coverage becomes less favorable to them. Trump seems to have survived a lot of that kind of scrutiny thus far and with flying colors. So that, I think that's somewhat unusual. You know, the Bernie Sanders story is an interesting one, and I don't have a good answer yet. We don't really know yet. To be honest with you, I'm waiting to see how well he does when people start voting before I think of how much time do we need to spend understanding the phenomenon of 2015. I do think that Bob is right, that there is some interesting evidence that the news media picked up on Bernie only after he began to get popular attention, which may have been, you know, organized via some, there may have been other coordinating devices in news coverage, such as social media, to help do that. So I don't know that the Sanders story is quite a media story in the same way that Trump's is. I think the common denominator is that people always need information, right, to be able to mobilize themselves politically or to have their minds changed about candidates or to become excited about candidates or what have you. And the question is just where that information comes from. And it may be somewhat different for Sanders, at least in the early going, than it was for Trump in particular.
And so just the last part one more time, we'll be able
to use the economy as a good factor.
Well, I think if we have even a modest amount of growth, or you know, whatever economic indicator you like, but if the economy is growing, if incomes are growing, whatever you want to use, the change, okay, so not the level, but the change, then they should leverage it. In my view, they should leverage that a lot. And it will go a long way. You know, I don't think there's anything that makes this year different from any of the other years in which we've seen the pattern hold. 75% of the time, these predictions predict the correct party outcome. That is far from perfect. There are a lot of misses. You know, John's orangutan flipping a coin would be right 50% of the time. But you can do a little better than that.
Pretend for a moment that you're the postmortem committee convened to tell us what went wrong so far for your party, like the Republicans had after the 2012 election. And they looked at things like too many debates, too few debates. They looked at things like were damaging things said or conveyed in the campaign. Were there negative ads like the Bain ad or the 4 a.m. ad, who's ready to lead ad in 08? If you were to assess who is in a better position today than a year ago, based upon what's happened so far, who has had the most damage done to them and why?
To their party?
Their party.
To their party.
And you have to assume it's Clinton and who knows who on the Republican side.
Yeah. I think it's certainly the Republican Party. I mean, they're alienating large swaths of the public. They don't seem to be in control. This was a party that was always prided itself on having an orderly nomination process. You know, that they always nominated the senior position in the party. This has gotten a little out of control, and I think the voters are seeing that. The Republican establishment, this is the second time, this is not the first time they have mud on their face. This is the second time, because in 2010, in the midterm elections, they completely missed the Tea Party phenomenon. They got themselves a subgroup of their caucus, only 65 members. The Tea Party caucus, when they convened in 2011, was only 65 members out of more than 200 in their majority. And yet they let, for years, that tail wag the dog of the Republican Party, ending up with the resignation of John Boehner. So this is a party that's kind of spiraling out of control and can't govern. And that's really what we've seen. So, you know, if we do have a President Trump, okay, which I suppose stranger things have happened, this will still, however, this... yeah, right. Maybe not. This will still be... This will be huge challenges for them governing, because they have not, that lately the Republican Party in the last 6 years, they've not been able to govern. And that, I think, is going to be to their detriment in the long run.
Yeah, I'm really puzzled with the Republicans why they were afraid to attack Donald Trump. And I'm serious about that, right? It just, the new Des Moines Register poll here in Iowa gives Trump a whopping 28%. He's leading, but there are 10 other candidates splitting 72% of the Republican vote in Iowa. it strikes me that after failing to figure out what happened in 2010, in some sense, the establishment side of the Republican Party overlearned 2010 and thinking, oh, you know, they're all out there. We need to do something about this. And 28% doesn't seem like it's enough to say we really have to keep hands off because we'll alienate all these voters. I also continue to believe that a lot of these people aren't actually voters. I mean, either historically or these giant crowds here in Iowa. Trump was at Drake, right, in place of the debate. Mm-hmm. And by the way, the debate got 4 times the ratings that Trump did, right? But I saw a tweet that I was going to misname the person anyway, it's gone. Was going up and down the line actually looking for Trump supporters. There were very few actual Trump supporters in that line waiting to get into the Trump event. So 28% support is nothing to sneeze at when there are 11 candidates, but 72% of Iowa Republicans are looking somewhere else. And I think that's the problem the party's facing. They can't figure out what do you do in a situation like this if they're afraid to do anything at all. I'm a big fan of negativity, and I'm really sorry they haven't gone after him much. Not enough attack ads. I'm really surprised.
We're going to take a question over here, maybe our second to last question.
Hi. I've been watching this very attentively with all of my courses here at the university. I'm a senior. And I watched Donald Trump's, as much as I hate to talk about Donald Trump, I watched his live stream when he came to Iowa City this past week. And I sat to myself thinking, you know, is he going to start talking about any kind of policy or any kind of substance? And no offense to anybody. But it seems to me you had mentioned when you were talking that the way to win against the incumbent party is to pick a topic and to use that topic to your benefit because you have a better record or a better experience with that topic versus your opponent. But given this discussion we've been having, this rhetoric that Donald Trump has been spewing, I'm curious as to how simply rhetoric is playing a role, because I went back and I've listened to Nixon, I've listened to Carter, listened to lots of other people, and during this time they're talking about substantive policy, they're talking about why their plan is better, why their plan is superior, what their plan actually is, and that's not happening, and Donald Trump is still leading.
Well, he is. He's talking about substance. So Make America Great Again is the new, we stand today on the edge of a new frontier. And his positions are, how are we going to make America great again? We're going to build a wall and keep the Mexicans out. We are going to stop Muslims from coming in. Those are substantive policy positions.
Okay, well, I should rephrase. He hasn't spoken about how he's going to do it.
Ah.
And that's watching Nixon, watching Trump, watching...
Yeah, I think, just very quickly, I think you have to be a little bit careful there. If you go back and listen to those 1960 speeches, you know, Kennedy's not saying, I'm going to take the money for the space program from this line in the budget, and I'm going to, you know, he's just saying, we're going to do this. We have to do it. So I don't think it's not that different once you embrace the fact that those are substantive policy positions.
There is a little more substance in many of the candidates when you go to the events. Mostly it comes out when Iowans ask them questions, not so much in the stump speech itself, which tends to be, you know, the more rhetorical side of things. But you know, Trump also doesn't really have to. I mean, in a sense, after these very broad, you know, we'll build the wall, everybody's, oh, yeah, yeah. So they, as Lynn said, they've now made it okay to say, you know, let's keep those Mexicans out, right? But once he's done that, all he really has to do is what he's doing, which is, I am a winner. With me, we will all be winners. America will win. Let's win together, so let's win. Vote for me and we'll win. And I'm really serious. That is the basic Trump rhetoric. And I'm going to be really fascinated if he comes in second in Iowa, how you play being a winner if you don't win.
I have one last question for our panel. Just so for those of you who are
very unique among all the candidates on the Republican or Democratic side, and as we say, not even city council, not even the state legislators, and certainly not a governor or a senator or other kind of executive leadership. My question for this panel would be, are we possibly witnessing like a reordering of like a new cleavage where we have a new kind of populist, the outsiders versus the insiders, Sanders, Trump versus Clinton, Rubio, Bush, and what does that mean, I guess? And that you can't see, but and we don't know. We're sitting here waiting to see if it happens, but it's so odd, this election is so odd. My question there, and then we'll close.
I'll take one stab at that. And the political scientist bias when asked a question that basically is, has something radically changed? is to say no, it hasn't. So, I think the way to frame this is does politics now give tools to different kinds of candidates to allow them to get a little bit further than they may have gotten in some previous year? If I were to frame Caroline's question like that, I could come up with an answer that says maybe, right? But I think we should be clear. Like, you know, Sanders, you know, is probably going to lose the nomination battle, and it may be over somewhat quickly. Now, that's not a hard and fast forecast, so do not quote that forecast. But like, if Sanders sort of recedes relatively quickly, okay, all right, then that, you know, that's all right. Well, that's feel the burn, so no more. Okay, that's done. You know, Trump is a unique character. How much do we want to generalize about changes in politics from him? I just don't know the answer to that yet. We might look back on this cycle and say, whoa, that was a weird year, right? But then there was some degree of normalcy restored to politics. That may be the ultimate thing. I mean, certainly the other outsider candidates like Carson or Fiorina got disposed of fairly quickly by the nature of the process.
Carson too.
Yeah, absolutely. So I just don't know yet that I'm ready to say something big has changed. That said, just the sheer nomination of Trump would be a significant occurrence. Obviously, if he wins the presidency, that's a deeply meaningful outcome. So, you know, a lot hinges. How's that preferred profundity? But a lot really depends on how well do these candidates do at the end of the day. There have been a lot of moments where we thought we were on the cusp of something. Howard Dean was gonna pull. Can you believe that outsider, Howard Dean, right? And then, no. So I want to wait at least a few months, if not a year, before we can start to say, really, what did this all mean? And what does it imply about the future? So that's my cautionary note, maybe.
The best thing about the Iowa caucuses is that it is used to say goodbye to candidates who lose here. And we are going to say goodbye to you, and thank you for coming.